Welcome back to Nuts by Speaker, to our special look at Pacific Island music legends. They started in Otara Garage in 1979 and went on to redefine music with their polyfunk sound. Lead singer Betty Ann won Best Lead Female Vocalist in 1999. That's right, I'm talking about Adi Ja. 30 years, 4 albums, a trip to Australia and back, and the band is still going strong. Marama Papao has their story.
It's a sound loved by many of our Pacific communities, Adi Ja. But before these Adi Ja favourites, Adi Ja was a well-known covers band. Ryan Monga and Betty Ann have been core members of the band since its early years. The mid to late 80s saw Adi Ja moving to putting out their own originals.
At first it was like I'd be doing a lot of the writing, and I'd bring the song in as like give it to the band like a cover, and we'd learn the song, and then we'd announce it like it was Prince's new song, and then we'd play it, and then the floor would just jam packed, you know, and it's like, wow, look, they're dancing to our music. And then the next day we'll do the same thing, but we'll say, oh, this is one of our own, and then no one would dance. And it was like, hey, hang on, they just danced to it last night, you know, and it's like, right, so you have to have it on radio and TV.
So in 1987, the band released the single and music video for Give Me Your Number. Adi Ja were named the first ever winners of the Reinach Rock Award. It helped them put out their first album. It was a sound their Māori and Pacific fans could connect with.
I think everybody made us feel like we were theirs, you know?
Yeah.
And they were ours, and they supported us all the way. That was probably one of the main reasons that we kind of like started doing our own stuff, was to hear sounds that we could relate to.
Ryan Monga's Pacific heritage has greatly influenced his music. Tahitian from his mother's side, and his dad's part Māori and Rarotongan.
We have socials on Fridays, Saturdays, and it was just fresh from the islands. When I was a kid, I used to sit right in between the drummers, and you know, one would start. Oh man, when you're right in the middle of it, it just sends chills down your spine. Then you know, the ukes and the guitar and the singing. And the reo mutua, which is the old type singing. Awesome singing, you know. It's real traditional stuff. And that's what I was brought up with when I became a teenager. Then I started getting into the funk stuff.
Ryan wanted his music to show Pacific people in a positive light compared to the negative press that was being given to Pacific community in the 70s.
A few years ago, these streets spawned gangs and so gang brawls as disillusioned youngsters fought amongst themselves, largely for the hell of it.
It wasn't hip to be a coconut, and that's what they used to call us back in those days. And it used to hurt, you know, hurt me a lot. And I knew that our cultures had a lot more to give than what they were, you know, the credit they were giving us. And especially in the music side of things, you know, the ukes and all of that stuff. I felt that it needed some sort of break into the national thing, so that people will see us for what we are rather than what they heard we were about, you know?
So New Zealand was recognising Adi Ja's polyfunk sound, and their 1988 album Take a Chance had 3 top 10 hits. The band moved to Aussie in the early 90s and found a huge following with many expat Kiwis. But when they decided to return to New Zealand in 95, they found not everyone was welcoming.
We were trying to find another record company to, you know, start up again, because we had problems with our first record company that we were with. We approached like BMG, and the A&R guy there said, oh, go and see Sony, they play elevator music. And I thought, what the hell? You know, it's like, yeah, okay. We did it before, we could do it again, you know.
Total control is what the band went after, setting up their own record label, Holly Funk Productions. In 1999, they had international success with the McCartney classic, Silly Love Songs.
And that was our first number one. Our first number one after how many years of being, you know, being in the industry. That's like 15 years. To me, it's like just the belief in the material and the belief in the direction and knowing who we are, you know.
And Ryan has words of advice for up-and-coming artists.
It's good to actually learn how to do it yourself and know the ins and outs of the industry, not just about music and not just about creating the music. Anyone can do that these days. It's about learning the journey and knowing that someone's got to pay for that ride in a limo and all the rubbing shoulders with the, someone's got to pay for it, and usually it's the artist.
Arijah's own plans for the future include an album for 2010. It's a big year for them, 30 years since Arijah's own journey began in a garage in Ōtara. And today they're optimistic about Pacific music.
Now to see it out there, you know, it's just awesome, you know. It's like finally we can relax, we can enjoy the sounds. It's definitely a lot more than what it was back in the day. You've got all of our artists out here doing the reggae thing, the polyphonic thing, like Nisha Mystic and all of that. To actually hear that out there is like, thank you, that's for us.